Well, it looks like we're ready to go. So first of all, welcome. It's June 26th, we hope. And tonight's topic is basically the story of two bodhisattvas, Prasannendriya and Agramati. And we'll get a little more into who they are, but I think it should be a fun story because many of us know who the celestial bodhisattva Manjushri is. And the story of these two bodhisattvas is actually his origin story. So it should be fun. First of all, a little bit of context. I took the translation from a book by Bhikshu Dharmamitra, which is called Marvelous Stories from the Perfection of Wisdom, for those who can see, which is basically 130 stories from the text that's mentioned here, the Mahaprajna Paramita Shastra, which is the commentary on the large Perfection of Wisdom Sutra. And it's a particularly important text, especially in East Asian Buddhism. It's been attributed to Nagarjuna, who lived sometime between 150 and 250 CE, and he's known best for works like the verses on the Middle Way, Mula Majjhima Karika, as well as his numerous exegetical works, many of which were probably not written by the same historical figure. Probably this commentary on the large Perfection of Wisdom being among those that were not actually written by the same historical personage as the verses on the Middle Way. But nonetheless, one of the things that he is most famous for is becoming the founder of the Madhyamaka or Middle Way sort of trend of thought in Mahayana Buddhism. And sometimes that's also translated as centrism, but because of our connotations about what centrism means, I choose to call it the Middle Way. And you'll see, actually, this is a sculptural representation of him, and you can see a bunch of snakes sort of coming over his shoulder. And legend has it that, well, his name comes from the fact that he was able to go into the kingdom of the Nagas, which are the giant snakes that in East Asian Buddhism came to be known as dragons. And they were believed to live under the sea. So Nagarjuna actually went down into the sea and recovered the large Perfection of Wisdom Sutra and the Prajnaparamita teachings and brought them back to dry land where we were able to hear about them. So you'll often see him depicted with the sort of Nagas around him as protectors. See again. This is going to be a hang-up. This isn't working. Yeah, go back. It's fine. Go for it. Sorry. Yeah. I'll just say play. All right. So the Madhyamaka, I think it's worth taking a little bit of time just to talk about sort of overall idea of the Madhyamaka trend of thought. And one of the things that's most important about them is, since they go by the name of being the Middle Way, that they took a radical position on the Middle Way that is more based on texts like the Prajnaparamita texts than the earlier texts from Nikaya Buddhism. Go ahead and click now. So the sort of early interpretation of the Middle Way was very clear. Shakyamuni Buddha advocated a balance between being devoted to asceticism on the one hand and devoted to hedonism on the other hand. So, as a prince, he had lived a lifestyle where none of his needs went unmet. And this was sort of the devotion to hedonism phase. And then he became a wandering ascetic. And during those sort of years of asceticism, he got very close to death through his severe ascetic practices. And it was really the discovery that he needed to be somewhere in between the two, not entirely devoted to either side of these things, that actually led him to regain the strength that he needed to be able to have this insight into the nature of reality that happens under the Bodhi tree. So if we were to sort of try to diagram what that early view of the Middle Way looks like, I would make it look like this, please, which is that there's sort of this line, a continuum between asceticism and hedonism. And then, if you don't mind clicking again for me, the Middle Way is some point in the middle of them, right? It's very clear. We've got the two. We pick the middle of the continuum, and we're all good. We're not too ascetic. We're not too hedonistic. Boom. Everything's solved. But for the Madhyamaka, they actually, being influenced by the Prajnaparamita text, took a very different view of what it meant to understand the Middle Way. So the Madhyamaka version of the middle way is more of a balance between devotion to the conventional phenomenal reality that we experience with our senses, that we inhabit as human beings, versus the notion of an absolute reality of shunyata, or the emptiness of all things. And that's to say that on one hand, we have our experience of the world as all of these discrete things that we interact with, and our personhood and all of these things. But then we understand that at an absolute level, all of these things are so causally intertwined that it doesn't really make sense to see any of them as necessarily discrete entities. They're all just sort of in a causal flux that we're experiencing from moment to moment. So if I were to try and diagram this, you could say there's this line between the conventional and the absolute, and people might tend to be really far on the conventional side, right? And they're only concerned with the things that are immediately available to them. Or they could be very off, head in the clouds on the other side of it. But in this case, you can't really just pick a spot in the middle of this line, because you really need to be able to see both sides of the picture in a very complete way to actually understand the middle in this sense. So please, one more. So I would say that sort of the Madhyamaka view, I would consider this circle maybe to be the middle way in that sense, which is that we have a complete view of the whole spectrum between the conventional and the absolute ways of seeing things, so that we can transcend those two limiting ways of seeing that whole nature of reality. And I think that that's sort of at least an important point for the story that we're going to look at. And this is a very sort of broad overview of Madhyamaka thinking. It's obviously a lot more complicated than this. There are many books, many thinkers, etc. Please, let's be next if you don't mind. So going to the text that we're looking at, and the reason I'm bringing in the commentary is because it's really the lead into the story and why we hear this story about the origin of Manjushri. And the Mahaprajnaparamita Shastra is a very interesting text in that it essentially became something like a Buddhist encyclopedia for any particular line of the larger Perfection of Wisdom Sutra. There could be pages and pages of commentary going into the minutiae of one sentence, and you get, you know, just carved out into this book, there are 130 didactic stories that they include to help explain the text and, you know, all kinds of things. So if you ever have a question about Mahayana Buddhism, this sort of is the text to go to, which is why it gets cited a lot in Tendai and Tendai Buddhism. So the particular sutra passage that we're looking at is actually from the introduction to that Perfection of Wisdom Sutra. And it's just this phrase, they were skillful in bringing about deliverance in accordance with reality. And the they in the sentence is bodhisattvas. So Nagarjuna feels like it's very important to sort of pick this apart and try and get some insight into what it means to be both skillful in bringing about deliverance, but specifically skillful in bringing about deliverance in accordance with reality. Especially because, as we saw for the Madhyamaka school, the notion of how to actually understand the relationships between these sort of two layers of reality is of the utmost importance for liberation in the Buddhist context. Next, please. So Nagarjuna provides a little bit of commentary before he goes into the story, and he begins with the point that there are non-Buddhist teachings which bring about liberation or deliverance in Dharmamitra's translation. And I think this is sort of an interesting claim in that it's not saying that all non-Buddhist teachings are equally great or, you know, comparable to Buddhist teachings. It just acknowledges that there are non-Buddhist teachings that can also bring about liberation. But the issue with them is that they are inappropriate. Continue, please. And then all Buddhist teachings are capable of bringing about liberation, but among them, there are also methods that are considered to be inappropriate. Once more, please. So that brings up the question of what it means for them to be appropriate. And in this particular context, he sees the appropriateness as having to deal with if they are in accordance with reality. So they can be skillful means that are useful, but they aren't necessarily going to be in accordance with ultimate reality. And so in that sense, they're kind of limited. Thank you. And this is, again, I'm going to bombard you with that same little diagram I drew a few times, so please enjoy. So, but this is the reality we want to be in accordance with, a middle way that sees both the absolute and the conventional. Not going to work that time. Thank you. So he provides two analogies to sort of try to give us a little bit of insight before we go into the story. And one of those analogies is thinking about somebody who needs to cross a stream. And so they build a raft made out of reeds. And certainly this gets them to the other side. And that's great and all. but wouldn't it have been better if they had a ship, right? And when you compare the two, the ship is obviously a superior way to travel across water. I mean, the reed raft gets you there, but it's much more stylish to take the ferry boat, right? And then the other analogy that comes up is talking about traditional medicine. And this one, I think, maybe we're a little far from the context in which it might be obvious to us, but Nagarjuna gives the example of, you know, people can be treated with things like bitter herbs, needles, etc. And all of these things do cure diseases, but in the attempt to cure somebody, they cause discomfort. The bitter herbs are unpleasant, the needles hurt, etc., etc. And so there's sort of a pain that leads to the cure. Versus a particular form of medicine that I did not find any more information about. And this is a back formation from the Chinese to Sanskrit, so take that as you will. But the Shudashanta medicine, which, at least according to this analogy, if somebody is ill, they can look at the medicine. They don't have to take it. Just looking at the medicine cures them instantly with no discomfort. And so if you were to compare the two, obviously you would say, well, that's the one I want, right? That's the superior medicine. And that's not to say that both of them aren't curative. It's to say that one of them is clearly better, right? Which is kind of the razor's edge that we're walking through this story, because it gets into the differences between the sort of Nikaya Buddhist way of seeing things and the Prajnaparamita vision. So it also is worth noting that he talks about the differences between Shravakas, which are sort of the Nikaya Buddhists who listen to the Buddhist teaching, practice the Four Noble Truths, the Eightfold Noble Path, etc. And he talks about how their method of practice involves the dutta practices, which we probably don't know, so I went ahead and wrote them down. And these are sort of ascetic practices that consist of eating only food that's offered, wearing only three robes, not accepting more food after starting eating, not lying down, having a bed that's in accordance with what is offered, and, you know, not a high bed or anything luxurious like this, living at the root of a tree, eating during one sitting, living in an empty place, living in a wilderness, living in a charnel ground, wearing only robes made from discarded materials, and wearing only felt garments. And these were ascetic practices that people continued to practice based on the Buddha's recommendations. And then aside from this, the other primary form of practice, as Nagarjuna is identifying it, is meditation, particularly trying to reach the four stages of the four jhana stages, which are sort of meditative absorptions. And then these should lead somebody to the stage of becoming an arhat, where they cut off their karmic chain, and then when they pass on in their current form, they will enter nirvana and be done. And he contrasts this to the bodhisattva practices. And he says that bodhisattvas, this is how he sort of distills it, is he says that bodhisattvas practice purification of the mind through contemplating the true reality of all phenomena, or the emptiness of those phenomena. So in other words, from his perspective, the Shravakas have built essentially a raft out of reeds, and the bodhisattvas have the awesome ship for crossing, right? Both of them get you to a similar place, but the bodhisattva version is sort of cutting, like, really right to the chase, right? It's like, we just need to awaken. That's what we need to do. Not necessarily spending all of the time trying to keep up all of these various sort of observances in our practice. So this leads us into a story. And the story is referred to as the origins of Manjushri, the Manjushri Avadana, I believe. And this particular text might be of interest to us because Manjushri is one of the celestial bodhisattvas, and in particular, the bodhisattva of wisdom. So this would sort of be who we would look to for an understanding of the Prajnaparamita, the perfection of wisdom. And the origins of Manjushri is presented as a story that's told by Manjushri to Shakyamuni Buddha. So Manjushri is the one telling the story. And you might be surprised to find out that this story happened a long, long time ago in another world far away from the one that we currently know, many, many eons ago. And at that time, there was a Buddha, and we're going to use the translated name, but here's the Sanskrit for fun, which is the Buddha, king of the lion's roar. And that Buddha's land is pretty amazing. It's described similarly to the other Buddha lands that we hear of in Sutra. You know, everyone there is these very high attainment bodhisattvas, and the king of the lions where Buddha is constantly preaching. The land's called Thousand Rays of Light. And it's said that he was able to convert so many sentient beings that in this land, even the trees were constantly preaching the Dharma to people. So as you were walking around, the trees would just be giving discourses on the Buddha's teachings. And he lived in the world for quite a long time, but he eventually passed into Nirvana. And when he did, his Dharma was said to remain in that world for 60,000 years. But by the 60,000 years later, eventually the trees stopped preaching the Dharma anymore. And basically most people had forgotten it, which puts them in an age analogous to Mapo, which we're supposed to be living in our current world, correct? So at this time, far after the Buddha, King of the Lion's Roar, had entered Nirvana, there were two bodhisattvas. One of them is Prasannendriya, or joyous faculty, and the other is Agramati, or superior intellect. And these two had very different approaches. Prasannendriya is somebody who was described as being very virtuous and also very direct in his character. And he did not shy away from the sort of complicated, abstruse Buddhist teachings. And the thing is, all of his disciples loved it. They really liked the complicated stuff. And one of the big things that he became known for was that he did not repudiate worldly things. He instead said that there wasn't really such a thing as something that was absolutely good or bad, and that by making those discriminations, people were really hindering themselves. And of course, his disciples, they totally got this. In fact, it came to be called the single mark wisdom, in that he was teaching this one thing over and over, which was not falsely discriminating things. And then through this, he actually led many of his disciples to awakening. And he had lay disciples and then also monks who were his disciples as well. And and one of the teachings that was given as characteristic of him is that he would tell his disciples all dharmas, even if they are marked by sensual desire, marked by hatefulness, and marked by delusion, in other words, the three poisons, the marks of all of these dharmas are identical to the true character of dharmas. There's nothing therein which serve to hang one up or obstruct one. And it may seem like this is maybe a dangerous approach to take, right? We're saying, oh, well, what's the difference between good and bad, etc. But we have to keep in mind that he was also understood to be somebody who did behave virtuously and had a strong character. And so his disciples also sort of had similar dispositions. So when he began to teach them this, these weren't people who were, like, you know, having a lot of issues functioning in society, and they weren't necessarily malevolent people, etc. They were people who were ready to hear something like this. So he taught them the single mark wisdom, and it said in here that because their thoughts were free of resentment, they gained the patience with regard to beings, other sentient beings. Because they gained the patience with regard to beings, they were able to realize patience with regard to dharmas. They dwelt in the Dharma of reality, remaining as unmoving as mountains. So in other words, all of his disciples were a huge success story. They really found this way to sort of be able to take a step back from their discriminating thoughts and not sort of ride this emotional seesaw that gets them caught up in issues with other people. And that led them to have a deep insight into the nature of reality, to understand phenomena as they are in that sort of middle way sense that we were talking about. Of course, there was also the Dharma master Agramati, who took a very different approach. And he sort of took the more classical approach of, he advocated ascetic practices, and his personal practice was the 12 dutta practices that we noted earlier, as well as he had cultivated the various jhana stages and was honestly a very accomplished meditator and ascetic practitioner and very into the precepts. And so this is what he taught his disciples about. So they were constantly kind of worrying about, you know, making sure that they keep all of the prohibitions and, you know, trying to be extremely diligent in all of these things and keeping the letter of the law and all of this stuff. And that was really what was the most important to Agramati for Buddhist practice, because he said these were the things that were taught by the Buddha. So Agramati, of course, along with others, they were making rounds to gather alms and talking to various people in town. And we should note that Prasannendriya and Agramati seem to share a sangha. They're visiting the same households and things like that, and when they go to the monastery, both of them are there. So Agramati's going around and he's visiting with people, and he shows up to somebody's house who happens to be one of Prasannendriya's disciples. And he knows Prasannendriya is not teaching these people about the dutta practices or any of this important stuff. And so he starts talking to this guy about moral laxity and starts explaining that, hey, you should be observing the various prohibitions, think about the limitation of your desires, all of these things. And at the end of this, he says about Prasannendriya, when this man speaks Dharma, he instructs people in a way which influences them to enter into erroneous views. He speaks of lust, hatred, and delusion as being devoid of any characteristic features which should constitute an impediment. He's a man whose conduct is rather mixed. He's not entirely pure. Now, imagine going to the guy's disciple's house and telling them that. But anyway, so this particular disciple is interested and says, okay, you know, he wants to talk to Agramati and understand better. And so he asks him, great virtuous one, this is the disciple asking Agramati, by what characteristic does one know the Dharma of sensual desire? And Agramati replied, well, sensual desire is characterized by afflictions, which is a pretty standard answer. So he was asked, well, do these desire-associated afflictions reside outwardly, in other words, somewhere out in the world, or inwardly, inside yourself? And Agramati responded that the desire-associated afflictions do not reside inwardly, nor do they reside outwardly. If they resisted inwardly, in other words, if they came just solely from me without interaction with things outside, then it couldn't be the case that they would rely on outward causes and conditions for their arising. Imagine if you just desperately wanted to eat a cake, but there was no such thing. This is the kind of picture you're getting of desire. If they resided outwardly, then they should have nothing to do with oneself and should therefore not be able to afflict oneself. That's a sensible answer. So then this layperson, the lay disciple of Prasannendriya, says, well, if it's the case that sensual desire... that's the insult. If it's the case that sensual desire does not come from the inside or from the outside or from the east or from the west or from the south or from the north or from any of the four midpoints or from above or below, and if it's the case that one can search everywhere and be entirely unable to find any real aspect in it, this dharma or phenomena then is neither produced nor destroyed. If it's devoid of any mark of production or extinction, it's empty of any inherent existence, and thus is entirely devoid of anything whatsoever which exists. How then can it be that it's able to be afflictive? That's a pretty good question. So, what did Agramati say? Nothing, because he didn't have an answer to this. And so his response was, he got up from his seat, and he said something to the effect of, Prasannendriya has engaged in an extensive deception of many people, and has influenced them to take up an erroneous path. And then he left. So, at this point, he's on this emotional seesaw, right? And it's kind of described in the text, giving a little more character to Agramati, that when you hear the Buddha talk, you know, way back when the Buddha was still living in this world, he would get really excited. When he heard the Buddha's teachings, he would feel really good. But then when somebody would talk about, you know, unwholesome things, like the things that are prohibited, etc., he would start to feel bad. And he was just kind of like yanked around by his emotions. And this sort of led him to go down the path of very strictly observing the precepts and specifically all of these ascetic practices and devoting himself to meditation to try and get rid of all of these unpleasant feelings. But the thing is, you can see from that he's experiencing some sort of aversion. He's trying to push them away, right? And he thinks that that's going to sort of solve the problem. And he has the same response here. Somebody gives him a very good objection, and instead of listening, he says, man, this guy is deceiving too many people. It's like, I'm taking this up the chain. We have to do something about him. So Agramati departed from that layperson's house, and then he went to the monastery, the same monastery where Prasannendriya often was as well. And he went there, and he started talking to all the monks, and he told them, you should all be aware that this Prasannendriya Bodhisattva has engaged in deceptions whereby he has extensively influenced people to engage in the unwholesome and the improper. How is this so? He has said, As for the characteristics of lust, anger, and delusion, as well as those of all the other dharmas, they are all characterized by mutual non-obstruction. Well, he didn't necessarily get a warm reception, we can imagine, but Prasannendriya shows up, and he's thinking to himself, what to do about this situation? I mean, Agramati is running around behind him, talking about how he's deceiving everybody, and he's trying to trick them into evil destinies and all of this stuff, and Prasannendriya really has, you know, a ton of disciples who agree with him. And, I mean, he doesn't really want to necessarily back down. Instead, his inclination is that he wants to try and help Agramati, right? Because he sees what's going on. And, I mean, the guy just went straight into disparaging him, you know, for being able to outthink him, essentially. So at this time, Prasannendriya had the thought that this man, Agramati, is extremely hateful, is covered over by unwholesome karma, and is going to fall into committing a grave offense at some point in the future. I should now speak the most profound dharma, as in capital D dharma, Buddha's teaching. Although he will gain nothing from it now, still, it will constitute for him a cause and condition for the path of Buddhahood in a future age. And so, Prasannendriya called for an assembly of all the monks. And when they got there, he began preaching, and he started with these verses. One's sensual desires identical with the path, and so it is with hate and delusion. In just this way, amidst these three, one finds the path of innumerable Buddhas. So if a man discriminates twixt lust and hate, delusion and path, this man strays far away from Buddha, just as heaven is far away from earth. The path, lust, hatred, and delusion are all one dharma, all the same. Should one who hears this cringe in fear, he's far away from Buddha's path. The dharma of lusts not born or destroyed and cannot cause the mind affliction. But if one has a view of self, this lust leads forth to the wretched destinies. In other words, the hell dwellers, hungry ghosts, etc. in a future rebirth. Seeing dharmas of existence and non-existence as different, those two sides of the middle way reality. One can't believe existence or non-existence. But knowing existence and non-existence as same, transcending supremely, one achieves Buddha's path, which is the same idea of being able to completely see those two different aspects of existence, non-existence, to be able to move beyond them as a form of the middle way. And so this is what he tries to convey to Agramati. And he doesn't stop here. It says in the text that he at least had 70 more verses like this, but they're not given. So but these are sort of the way that he went off. And you know, when he started giving these 70 verses, there were a bunch of Shravaka disciples in attendance, and they all immediately became bodhisattvas, and like they were instantaneously arhats. Like they had these huge moments of awakening just hearing these 70 verses he gave. And of course, Agramati was there as well, and presumably he also had this great awakening experience, right? Well, the answer is no. He went straight to hell. And he was there for many, many eons. In fact, it's quite harrowing in the text. He spends a ton of time in the hells, and then eventually, when he is able to make his way out of the hells, and he again is born as a human being, he doesn't even hear the word Buddha for lifetime after lifetime because of what he had done in his life with Prasannendriya. So eventually, over time, he became a monk again, and he started following the precepts and doing essentially what he was doing before. But then in future lifetimes, he abandoned it again, and he became a layperson. Well, then he kind of became a wandering shramana, right? Like a religious seeker through several future lifetimes. And as all this was going on, Prasannendriya Bodhisattva eventually reached Buddhahood and actually moved on to a different land where he was the Buddha of his own place, known as the Buddha Jewel Adornment. And, he was in the land Jewel Adornment and had the name of Sun-Surpassing Brilliance King Buddha. And at this point, we get back into Manjushri telling the story to Shakyamuni Buddha. And Manjushri says, at that time, the Bhikshu Agramati was myself, which of course was the reveal we were all expecting, right? Because if it's his origin story, he had to come from somewhere. He had to learn something. I observe that for just such a period of time, I endured this immeasurable amount of suffering. Manjushri again addressed the Buddha, saying, if there be a man who seeks the path of the three vehicles and who doesn't wish to undergo all manner of suffering, he should not attempt to discredit the true character of dharmas, cherishing hatefulness in doing so. And there's a good message for you. So the Buddha asked Manjushri, what benefits did you gain from listening to those verses? And Manjushri says, when I heard these verses, they served as the causal basis for my achieving the ending of the multitude of sufferings, such that eventually, in life after life, I gained sharp faculties and wisdom. I became able to understand the profound Dharma and became able to skillfully expound the profound meaning. I became foremost among the Bodhisattvas in this regard, which of course is what Manjushri is known for. Bodhisattva wisdom. Well, yes, all's well that ends well. And really the commentary just concludes with saying, yeah, this is what it means by being skillful in bringing about deliverance in accordance with reality. So there's not really much more of the commentary after that. It ends with the story. So there are lots of things we could talk about from this story, but I chose to just limit myself to a couple of them. One of the things that I wanted to bring up is sort of, I feel like it can't be said enough times, even though we've all heard it and we all know it, that you shouldn't assume that you know everything. I feel like it's very obvious, and yet we kind of find ourselves behaving that way from time to time. And one of the key things that happened in this story, right, is that Agramati sort of let his views of Buddhist practice get very fossilized in this one set of practices. And he didn't really want to branch out of that. He just kept doing that, and he sort of figured, oh, well, everything's all good, right? And so he assumed that when he started hearing somebody saying something that contradicted it, even though they were a member of the Sangha and also a fellow Dharma master and Bodhisattva, instead of trusting what they were saying, his immediate assumption is, this guy must be wrong. And part of it was probably jealousy, as we know, you know, that he was getting upstaged a little bit by Prasannendriya's disciples. But nonetheless, that was the attitude that he took. Another key from this story is that disparaging others causes problems for you. So even if it causes problems for the other person, it will cause you problems as well. And in the story, it's pretty clear. Agramati ends up in hell for a very long time and is set back many, many, many lifetimes, considering that he was already a Bodhisattva when he made this mistake and then had to start back in hell and work his way back up through the ranks. But I think, like, in a more in a sort of less fantastical way, I mean, we can think about, examples of people who they're really into trying to come up with a way to exclude other people. And then they find that after they've accomplished their goal, it comes back to bite them. And they end up facing the same sort of discrimination. And I mean, we can liken it to, I think, people who try to, for instance, impose their religious views through the law or through, you know, large public platforms, try and sort of intimidate people into following their particular views, et cetera, without really having an open mind about the value and truth of other people's traditions and beliefs. And I see that as sort of an analogous situation to what Agramati was trying to do in a way. Prasannendriya has his own thing that he's doing, and he believes that he's correct. And in fact, he seems to have it a little more together than Agramati did in the story. Yet, when Agramati doesn't have a sufficient answer to Prasannendriya's disciple, instead of seeing that as an opportunity for him to learn more, he goes around and starts denouncing Prasannendriya and trying to cause trouble with him with the rest of the Sangha, saying this guy is out deceiving people, he's leading them away from Buddhism, et cetera, et cetera. And I feel like, you know, you can turn on many channels and hear people saying similar things about various members of our society on a daily basis. So just to keep in mind that in general, disparaging other people causes you problems as well as the other person. So you're not going to get away from it scot-free, let's say. With respect to Buddhist practice, I think one of the things that's important in this story is what leads to the sort of situation that Agramati's in is that he really picks that one set of practices, and that's all he's going to do. And he's not willing to branch out. And that, of course, is what leads him to have the sort of lack of forbearance that Prasannendriya's disciples have, to be able to listen to what other people have to say about things, not immediately have like some knee-jerk reaction of trying to upstage them or whatever. And so it might have been helpful for Agramati to have actually listened to what Prasannendriya was teaching other people and try to apply some of these practices himself before he ended up in hell for a very long time. Of course, that's not the way the story went, but that's a lesson that I think we should take away from it, is that there is always time for us to try to look at other practices and try to see where our insufficiencies are and what the things are that we need to work on. But in many ways, that's up to you. I mean, you have to be honest with yourself about how you feel about things and what's going on in your life for that to be really useful. And then, of course, related to Buddhist teachings, I just wanted to bring up that Buddhist teachings, we base a lot of our interpretation on things like the Lotus Sutra and the Nirvana Sutra, where we understand the various Buddhist teachings as being part of the one Buddha vehicle. They're all leading to the same place, but they're different approaches and different methods that are appropriate for different people at different times in their lives. And I really wanted to hit this point just because I think it's very important to us as Tendai Buddhists, because Tendai Buddhism is a multi-practice school. So we don't really say, oh, you just need to meditate and that's going to get you there. Or you just need to recite Nembutsu and that's going to be enough. Instead, we have a whole host of practices. And I think it's very typical for people to maybe start with one practice and then as they move through the years, try a different one here, different one there, etc., as they need to emphasize different things. And for instance, you know, some of the ones that we talk about are devotional practices, meditation, of course, ritual practice, mantra recitation, calligraphy, even scholarship. As you would see from Sensei and Ichishima Sensei, I would say that they make scholarship definitely a part of Buddhist practice. As well as even things like doing the chores and work practice, like when we have Sangha work days and things like that, or when you're doing your house chores. All of those can be done as a Buddhist practice as well, depending on how you do them. But the key, as I see it, is to sort of keep moving and not get too comfortable with the feeling that you've done enough because you've gotten really good at one particular way of practicing or one particular method. And I think that's illustrated by the story in the fact that Manjushri takes, in the text it says, an innumerable number of lifetimes to finally understand the verses that he had heard from Prasannendriya. But as a result of having all of that time to process them through the various lives that he lives during that time, he's able to become the Bodhisattva of wisdom, who is the foremost in teaching among all of the Bodhisattvas and is renowned as such today and probably one of the most popular Bodhisattvas. So with that, this is the young child, Manjushri, riding a lion. So first, I'm not sure if Ichishima Sensei is there, but I'd like to get comments from the senseis. Yeah, it looks like he is not. So Sensei, if you have anything that you would like to add.
Yeah, I really appreciated your presentation. I don't really have very much to add to what you had had spoken about, because I think it's sort of self-contained and it's interesting to take a look at some materials that normally we don't look at.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of them.
Yeah.
And so I appreciate very much your presentation. Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome. And that's one of the reasons I like to sort of, I've been making my way slowly through this book of, because a lot of these didactic stories are sort of interesting. And they give you insight into things about the past of a lot of the characters that we've sort of, you know, we see them in their perfected form as they're revered now. But, you know, you get all these interesting stories sort of about their journey to eventually getting there. Or also fun ones like Bodhisattva or the long nails that we talked about before. So I guess we'll go ahead and stop the recording and then we can open it up for questions and comments.